shoot this music.
Welcome back. Welcome back to our second episode of Hungry Talks. We've finished our training and we're ready to really sink our teeth into the meat and potatoes of the show. And I promise that was not intentional.
Episode one was eventful. My mum was here, Matrix references, and a whole lot of fun. It's been an eventful year since Hungry Talks 2022. So we thought it'd be appropriate to catch up on what's happened in the world of advertising and beyond since our last season. A year of review of sorts. But before that, I would like to acknowledge that we are joining you today from the land of the Wurundjeri people. We pay our respects to their elders past, present and emerging, and we are using this land as a place of learning and creativity, which the Wurundjeri people have been doing for thousands of years before us, and we extend that respect to any Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander peoples here today in the audience.
So, it's been an interesting few months. We've been seeing leading brands lean heavily into digital means of advertising, such as McDonald's recent take on viral marketing involving their Grimace-themed milkshake, or even Pop Corners taking advantage of meme culture's obsession with Breaking Bad for their Super Bowl commercial. These are all clever uses of rapidly changing online space, but not something that we haven't seen before. And many brands are now taking advantage of recent developments with the experimental technology of generative AI.
That's right, Charlie. Not too long after the creative capabilities of AI became a trending topic, big name companies such as Coca-Cola have used AI to create video commercials advertising their products. Even stepping in the world of outside of advertising, Marvel recently used AI technology to generate the title card sequence for their Secret Invasion series. It's safe to say that in the last few months, AI has cemented itself as a creative tool. It's scaring the shit out of a lot of creatives. But there's a lot to learn about it and how to manage it.
AI has even shown its strategic strength within advertising, with Google recently announcing that it will provide AI-powered ads to businesses, simply by registering your business and the goods or services you provide. That's more than enough for their advanced AI to generate copy, visuals, target audience, and a strategy plan.
It sounds impressive, but like, what exactly is AI? It's a pretty broad term. Is it really the next big thing all the tech bros say it is?
AI has demonstrated its power in various industries, such as healthcare, finance, and even entertainment. Its ability to analyze vast amounts of data and make predictions has revolutionized decision-making processes. However, as AI continues to advance, concerns arise about its potential to replace jobs and compromise creative integrity.
And those fears aren't really exactly misplaced. ChatGPT has demonstrated the ability to almost perfectly replicate human writing. So much so that some of you viewers at home probably didn't notice that Charlie's last statement was generated almost entirely from AI speech models.
But before we continue, I wanted to play around with AI myself and see what I could come up with.
And?
Okay, hear me out. Why did the sandwich give a speech at the food conference?
Because you love cheese?
No, because it has some hungry talks to share with the world.
Yeah, so the audience being forced to laugh right now. They're held at gunpoint. No offense, that joke sucks. Hold on. I'm asking AI right now for another. Why did the sandwich go to therapy?
Oh, I know this one. Because it had too many hungry talks and couldn't handle the emotional weight of being constantly spread thin.
What? How could you possibly know that?
I'm never going to reveal my secret. Moving on, factoring AI's impressive skill set and the corporate world's embrace of the technology, a lot of young creatives are concerned about what the development will mean for their career. But let's focus on the now. How can we use AI impact to your studies?
Well, using ChatGPT to do your uni work for you seems pretty harmless, but when it does, it goes from being a useful and helpful tool to impacting academic integrity. Keeping with our 90s themes, we ask every guest to share a photo of them from the 90s. Unfortunately, we can't share one of those without it being an unrecognizable baby photo. I was born on December
31st, 1999.
And 2002. Here's a photo of our next guest, RMIT Digital Learning Specialist Kellyanne, who joined us a little while ago. Here's what she has said, had to say.
Thank you so much for joining us. What does AI look like for you in your workplace and within education?
So what we're seeing right now, like at the library, is a lot of questions about how students can use tools like ChatGPT and some of the image generating tools like Midjourney, Night Cafe, Adobe Firefly, things like that. There's a lot of confusion in terms of what students are allowed to do, what is ethical to do. The area is evolving really rapidly.
Yeah.
So we have ideas about like how things might look today, but we're still not sure about what things are going to look like in the future.
Yeah. And so because it's something that changes so fast, how do you keep up from an education point of view? Is there sort of something already in place to recognize that technology?
Yeah, so it's a really interesting question. So the university does have some guidelines. How much AI can you use in an assignment? Yeah. Sometimes it's very open and sometimes it's really narrow or none at all. So the bodies that create the guidelines for referencing, so like if you do APA referencing, for example, they get together every few years to update those guidelines. Not very frequent. Yeah. Right now, with like ChatGPT kind of at the end of last year, beginning of this year, everybody was like, how are we going to reference this? What do we need to do? We need to know this now. And these organizations are like, maybe we'll know next year.
Yeah, we'll get to it next year.
Exactly. But the library does have a referencing guide. You go to EasySite, and then when you see the list of source types, there's a link now for information that was generated by AI.
Okay.
And it'll take you to a guide, and we're trying to keep that as updated as possible.
Yeah. People might be using AI to help them write, or they might be using it as a brainstorming tool. I know in our course we are almost encouraged to use ChatGPT to take an idea that you already have and then build on it. That AI isn't the idea, it just is the tool that helps the idea.
Exactly, yes. Yeah. So we do have guidelines for both the text, any text you generate, as well as images that you generate. And so you're considering that material that you've used AI for as the property of AI, or is it students' property?
That's a really, really tricky question. So right now that's actually a big question in terms of copyright, like who owns this information?
Yeah.
You know, when we think about referencing, we're acknowledging information that came from somebody else, but with generative AI, we don't have that ability. In terms of who actually owns it, I think it's still an unsettled question.
In terms of AI outside of education, in a commercial space, how do you think AI can be used ethically in commercial work?
Obviously, AI is changing many, many industries, and careers are going to look very different going forward.
Yeah.
I think that the people who are going to be successful using AI in the future are people who use it to complement the work that they're doing. Yeah. It's not going to replace people. It's not good at recognizing and understanding context, and it's not good at like empathizing with people. You might use the AI to help you with certain data analysis, but it's still going to need a human to come in.
Yeah.
And so I think that those uses are going to be ethical uses. But the sort of mechanics underneath ChatGPT, they were trained to recognize patterns based on text and artwork from the internet that they didn't have the right to use.
So they made a different piece, but what they used to create that piece, they did not.
Correct.
And AI, it's like a 78% male dominated industry. So we're seeing sort of the same gender bias of what was previously happening, especially in healthcare, where a lot of science was perhaps led by men at the beginning, and then with AI, a lot of that coding is being written by men. What are some of the downsides of AI?
So the biggest one is that I think a lot of people don't realize the AI doesn't actually know anything. It answers your questions really confidently, but basically what it's good at is making language that sounds like natural language,
right?
But it doesn't actually have answers. This is why you might find, if you've used it, you get an answer and you ask it for the source. Where did this information come from?
Yeah.
Which is, you know, a good student
practice, it will not give you real sources because it doesn't know where the information came from. And if you're trying to do an assignment with scholarly resources, you're not going to get those resources with those tools. There's a lot of interesting and fun things to do with it, but if you're trying to get information for an assignment, there are better ways to get, you know, accurate, reliable information.
Yeah, written by humans.
Exactly.
Ideally.
Peer reviewed.
So now that we have a clearer understanding of what AI should look like in an educational space, what about in the workplace? The rules for workplaces and their engagement with AI are very loose, allowing them to use it however they see fit for the most part, which is why when unions such as the WGA ask for corporations to regulate their use of AI out of fear that writers would get replaced by speech models.
This led to current writers' strike in Hollywood, which is still ongoing. And with corporate leaders not wanting to budge and no end in sight for this strike, showrunners are getting desperate.
Episode 2 deadline is coming up fast, all right? I need something good and I need something topical. I need something that's gonna blow the viewers' socks off, all right? Some of you guys, not naming any names, have been a bit sloppy. No, you, ChatGPT, you've been great. But the rest of you, I need ideas and I need them now. So, what do we got? Too tacky. Unknown error. Oh, come on, man. I just complimented you. Snapchat AI, what do you got? Maybe I shouldn't have let up on my human self.
Funnily enough, what I heard you was just what went down in the HBO writer's room while writing The Idol. The producers got really frustrated, turned off all its explicit filters, and then just let them run wild, which explains a lot, actually.
So, it's obvious that the use of AI in entertainment has been pretty hit or miss, with the profession demanding creativity. AI can fall behind really quickly. But what about advertising? While the profession absolutely requests creativity, sometimes being able to do something that's already been done before is at certain times what the clients need.
So what does this mean for the industry as a whole? We reached out to Tyler Hamilton, a Melbourne-based creative technologist that works across all things AI. Here's a photo he shared with us from the 90s. Let's see what he thinks the industry has in store for AI. Here's what we had to say during the week.
Hi Tyler, thank you so much for coming in and agreeing to this interview with us. It's very nice to talk to you and talking to like a past student to see how you've ended up. I've heard you recently got a new job, so once again, congratulations on that. I just wanted to discuss like AI with you and kind of like what it means for workplaces now.
Yeah, sure. So I think one of the first things with AI is sort of figuring out what it does and what it doesn't do. So a lot of people are thinking about AI is some big magic box that's going to solve everything, but I start looking at it as almost like a fancy version of your phone's autocomplete. Sure, it can do a lot of great things, but at the end of the day, that's pretty much all it's doing. I actually heard of a really good term today that I haven't quite memorized yet, but somebody started calling it salami, which I thought was perfect. It's systematic approaches to learning algorithms and machine interfaces.
Oh wow.
So yeah, when you start saying stuff like, oh, you know, salami's going to solve all my problems, salami's gonna take our jobs, it starts to sound a little bit silly, and then you can take a step back and go like, okay, yeah, sure, it's not quite artificial intelligence. Mm-hmm.
It's just like a tool used like different from what we've had.
Exactly, yes.
What's your day-to-day use with it in your industry?
At the moment, I'm using it a lot to create chatbots.
That's
kind of how AI on the surface is being used. But what I really like about AI is what it can actually do to sort of achieve different processes and projects that you're creating. So one project that I'm creating, it's a little sort of chatbot that calls you up every morning to sort of like check how your day is going, help you plan everything.
Uses
AI to sort of create a little schedule for you. But one of the cool things about AI which is why I think it's going to be really important for the creative industry, is how easy it is to make things like that. So prior to that, you need to, you know, learn all of this code,
yeah,
all of the infrastructure, but now you can pretty much just go into an AI and go, hey, write me this thing. And scarily enough, it gives you that. So I think there's a really good opportunity for a lot of creatives to pretty much to start making things that they just thought they couldn't before.
What are like the constraints of AI, and what are like copyright restrictions and things like that in the industry?
So this is where it gets tricky. This is the fun stuff.
Yeah.
So it's the Wild West at the moment. Nothing has been tested from a legal point of view.
Yeah.
And I'm not smart enough to talk about that, but there are a couple of examples that you can kind of look at, mm-hmm, that indicate where things might go. So back in the 1880s, I think it was,
yeah,
they had the same debate around cameras.
Yeah.
So they were wondering, oh, can you actually even like own or copyright an image that you've taken a photo of? Because it's the camera that did it, it's not you. But it gets really tricky with AI, because the way that AI works, it scrapes pretty much all of the internet, unfortunately takes a lot of people's, mm-hmm, creative works and IPs and uses that to generate new content. So there's a bit of a question around like, oh, who actually owns that? Is it the people that created the data originally? Is it the people that created the AI?
People who input the data into the AI,
exactly,
to create that result?
Yeah, and do you do enough work to that output to indicate originality? So
yeah,
that's going to be one of the big challenges that pops up.
Yeah.
No one has an answer to that just yet. And then there's another point that could be very interesting when using it for sort of the client briefs, is how people feel about the technology.
So what is AI?
Yeah, I mean, I always fail at kind of explaining it, but you can essentially like, you can define the input, you can define the output.
Yeah.
And then there's this just big black box in the middle that's, you know, essentially like tweaking dials and knobs constantly until, mm-hmm, it gets the right output.
Yeah.
You have to be like really, really, really in the weeds, pretty much building the AI to actually understand what's going on in there. But even then, the big ones created by like OpenAI, which is what powers ChatGPT, even their software engineers don't know what's kind of going on in, mm, there. But at the end of the day, all it's doing is creating a big probability tree of what we think the next output's going to be. So again, like your phone's autocorrect.
Yeah. Why do you think people are like so terrified of it?
Yeah.
Or is it because of like the jobs or like the unknown?
Yeah, I think all of those definitely play a part of that. Like every time we see a massive innovation in any technology, like even in the industrial revolution,
yeah,
job markets change quite incredibly. But I also think we've got a really good opportunity now to just even redefine the way we work. Like my hope is that AI can sort of help us achieve more of what we want to do. I mean, that's my dream and vision anyway. But yeah, again, a lot of it is also the branding of it too. Artificial intelligence is a big scary word, mm-hmm, yeah, but it gets less scary when you start calling it your phone's autocomplete. I don't think it's like a force for evil. I think it's,
yeah,
it's going to be something that can really help empower people, and it's
and
a tool.
Like speed up the process,
exactly,
of just like getting through maybe the brainstorming aspect, mm, or things like that. And also adding on to that, is there like any recommendations for like students on how we can use it specifically and, mm, what features it offers?
Jump into it as soon as possible.
Yeah.
Learn as much as you can about it. But you're also kind of in a bit of the gold rush of AI as well. I know a lot of brands are very excited about it. So you do have a really good opportunity to almost be the first person to do X or first person to do Y. But that also comes with a bit of a caution too, because you've also got to remember that, you know, AI is not the idea.
Mm-hmm.
You have to think about like, what is AI doing to improve the idea?
Yeah.
Is the idea the same with or without AI? And I think that's a really good thing just to keep asking yourself and thinking about it anytime you start implementing it.
Yeah.
But, and I've said it many times, it is going to help you achieve things that you never thought you were going to be able to before. So
that's amazing.
If there was,
yeah,
a really good project brief that you wanted to complete, you're like, oh, That requires like a tiny bit of code and I've got no idea how to do that.
Maybe we can get this assistance too.
Exactly. I wonder if the AI can do that part for me.
At what stage of the process do you use AI in terms of like idea generation or like refinement and...
Yeah, no, like great question. And it's basically, all the way through the process. So yeah. I know you mentioned before, Charlie, it does great things with brainstorming. Like you might have one idea and you just stumble across writer's block. You're like, oh, I need to get the ball rolling.
Yeah.
Let's do a couple of ways of doing it like this. Also, definitely creating cool things in advertising. So one of the projects that got me really excited about advertising was this one created by Snickers called The Hungerithm. It scraped Twitter to see how angry the internet was on that day. And depending on that, it fluctuated the price of Snickers at 7-Eleven, so you could print out your little price tag. And that was one of the biggest ones that was using the whole idea of the Internet of Things, how brands could all of a sudden be connected to the internet and advertising could be real time and interactive. I loved that. And that's definitely something that I'm going to do a lot more just in the world of advertising. I think using AI is sort of the interactive component as part of a campaign. And brands are already starting to do things along the lines of that as well. So I know some brands are experimenting with, let's see what happens if we take all of this AI data about our target audience, output that into thousands of ads and let's just run that.
See if you can get any more insights from
it. Exactly, yeah. So it really speeds up the whole, research side of things. Yeah, exactly right.
Any tips with AI, actually?
Yeah, I mean, I'll always go back. AI is really cool. Like, please learn it and please start being creative with it.
We mentioned earlier about Coca-Cola using AI to assist in creating a video commercial. And with such a big brand using a polarizing and experimental technology, we thought it would be a great choice for this week's Ad of the Week.
Cozy guys, right? Here to discuss this out of the week is Aimee, Claudio, and Tom. Auto cue. These are some of my great friends from the advertising course. What'd you think of it, Claudio?
It's a really cool ad. It's like I've seen a lot of this kind of AI-generated content, and it all kind of looks pretty similar in the sense that everything's kind of like morphing and changing with everything around it. I feel like AI really enjoys doing that.
Sort of like a surrealism.
Yeah, definitely, yeah.
And I think that's probably one of the clearest points. Well, one of the clearest differences, I think, because you can tell there is that weird surreal feeling to it. And it is interesting the amount of time it probably took with AI compared to traditional like production means. So I think in that way, it it gives creatives a lot more options and probably increases accessibility for smaller brands to do things like that in the future.
Yeah.
Do you think because you knew that it was made by AI, it like makes you look at the ad a little bit different? Like, how does it make you feel as an ad? Like, it's still a very creative, interesting ad. How does it make you think about it, knowing that it is AI?
Or it's like, do you like it less because AI created it and not a real person?
I forgot it was AI, like, like halfway through I'm like, oh my god, it's AI, but I don't know, I'm indifferent towards it. I'm sure like someone came up with the idea, like the whole plot of the ad, so
I have some friends that work in film and TV, and like video editing in particular, and they like, they have mixed feelings about it. Like not like that they say it's not real art, but they, yeah, and I'm sure you've like heard this kind of argument, but people have mixed opinions about I suppose like how much creative input actually goes into it, and how much of it is AI generated. So yeah, it's one of those things, I feel like.
Yeah. And kind of like the Harry Potter vibes with the paintings kind of interacting with each other.
And yeah.
Night at the Museum was good.
Yeah,
exactly.
Yeah, I was getting strong inspiration from that.
Yeah, I love that movie. and the sequel too. So for me, it brought out my inner child. And it hasn't affected my consumer sentiment towards Coca-Cola at all.
That's good. I personally don't drink Coca-Cola, but their ads are brilliant.
Yeah, well, good on them then.
Yeah. it's a scary time with advertising. I mean, you know, how do you three feel about it as a whole? As advertising students, we've got a bit of... These guys have been wanting to be on screen for a very long time, so... They're fighting for screen time, so please just bear with them.
Well, my opinion is you can't lose a job you don't have. I don't work in advertising yet, so good luck making me redundant.
Yeah, I don't think AI will make people redundant or like kill jobs in the industry. I think it's actually gonna increase the amount of jobs in the industry, especially like this early on. It's one of those things that's still so early on in AI. The potential for it is kind of still down here. And I think it's only gonna open up more opportunities in the industry. Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm sure it was the same with like Photoshop and Illustrator. Mm-hmm. Like when art directors used to like draw everything out, exactly. And then now you can do it on a computer. It's just something you get used to and adapt to and like figure it out.
It's a big change now. Even like if we're talking about artists and looking at painting and everything, and then imagine when photos came through and photography became such a huge thing. It became a debate, are photos art or is like abstract art considered like fine art? So it's a very similar concept through a different lens.
For sure.
Yeah, it's just so new. Yeah. Like anything, people are scared of what they don't know and change. Yeah, so yeah, we're still early days for AI, but I don't think it's a bad thing at all. I know a lot of people have mixed feelings, but I think it's actually quite exciting.
Yeah.
I agree with that. There's a lot of potential there. And makes me ask, have you guys used ChatGPT at uni?
No. I tried to make a ChatGPT and then I didn't get the login code for my email, and then I tried to reactivate it and it didn't work, and then I just gave up.
That's too much effort.
Yeah, I gave up. I just made a bowl of cereal instead.
It's good. I like the compromise.
Yeah, it's good to use it to see its limitations as well. Mm. Like, if you don't use it, it's easy to see it, this tool that's just going to like steamroll everything, but it needs a person there as well. And I think for a lot of things, it just increases accessibility. It means that more people can be creative. There's going to be more competition, which is going to mean better ads. Yep. There's also going to be more probably mediocre AI-generated, like, mid ads out there, which then... mid, yeah, exactly, L plus ratio. But the good thing is, in that, it means that for people that have, like, well-thought-out ideas that really hit the brief properly, that you can cut through and create stuff that really matters and good work with the help of AI.
Yeah, definitely. I would say like I've used it a couple of times to try and like get a sort of radio ad going. It was terrible, but there was like one line that I really liked, reworded it, and then I made an ad around it. And it's like that kind of just sprinkling bits in. It's good for foundational work, yeah. I find.
I was gonna say, sure. I think people expect AI is just gonna do like whole creative things for them, and I don't think that's really its purpose at the moment anyway.
Yeah, and I suppose anything created from AI shouldn't really be something that you wanna create, because then it's not new. That means it's just sourcing it from all other areas, yeah. And yeah.
And I think like with AI as well, as long as you're honest about using it, I think otherwise it can seem a bit weird and people get uncomfortable with it. But if you used AI, be honest about it, and then people can make up their own minds.
Yeah. It's a robot. Ooh. Scary. Hey, Charlie. You know what I think this ad needs?
Oh, no. Here we go. What is it?
A jingle.
Oh, here we go again.
Roll it.
Okay, so you didn't get that jingle. That's fine. How about we try another one?
Okay, yeah, but let me go first.
All right, fine. Lucky you're with Aimee.
Yeah.
See? Yeah, great. Well done.
Okay, now you go.
All right, my turn. Yeah.
I'm sorry, what?
Oh, come on, how could you not get that one? It is the most iconic jingle for years.
Maybe, but you sang it so slowly, I literally fell asleep.
Oh, come on, how could you miss the jump at the end, or were you just asleep the whole time?
No, that wasn't the Toyota ad, surely.
Yes, see, you're getting the hang of it. It's exactly what it was.
Have I convinced you about the power of jingles yet?
Oh, this had a purpose? I just thought you've gone mad or something.
Gone mad? From what?
Well, from this, I mean, we've talked to so many people so far about AI, and I still don't understand it and know what it fully means. I think maybe we should ask AI itself.
Couldn't agree more. Now it's time to introduce our live guest this week. Sadly, Paul Reardon at TBWA is no longer able to join us in the studio this week, but he will feature in an episode later in the series to discuss AI and its place in the creative industry. So our live guest this week, mystery, blah, 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 very fittingly, ChatGPT. You ask me questions,
yep.
I'll ask it questions.
Perfect. All right, let me think. Why are so many people fascinated with AI recently?
Fascinated by AI. It says, because it has the potential to revolutionize many aspects of our lives, from healthcare, education, and entertainment.
Okay, yeah, that's pretty cool. But all this is an advertising show. Ask what it can do for advertising.
What can it do for advertising? It says that it can help advertisers better understand their target audiences and create more personalized and relevant ads.
Yeah, okay. And?
All right, and it's saying that it can help automate certain tasks such as ad placement and optimism, saving time and money.
Well, does it think that we should be worried about it taking our jobs?
It says no, but it's in the early stages and that there will always be a need for human creativity and critical thinking within advertising, you know, human touch.
Well, ask it why so many corporations love using it then.
Why do corporations love you? AI says, because ultimately it can help improve efficiency, cut costs and gain a competitive edge, which is ultimately the goal of a company.
Okay, well, I suppose I'm glad AI can help them, but what about us?
Chat says that it can help us by applying itself to aspects of our folio, such as digital graphics, generating copy and correcting key documents, such as cover letters and resumes.
And is that all the advice it has for us?
Well, no, it actually also says that it's natural to be concerned, but it doesn't think we should worry too much about it. It just says to keep our folios unique, fresh and engaging, and to stay up to date with the latest technology that's being embraced in advertising. So I think AI is kind of a bit generic, boring, and it's just kind of a tool we can use, like the guy said earlier.
Yeah.
We shouldn't be too concerned about that.
Okay. Well, I guess that kind of levels out the playing field to some extent. No, don't type that. I was just saying that.
Oh, sorry, all the typing just wore me out.
Okay, well, I'd rather the opinion of a real human. And actually, I have some follow-up questions I have for Tyler Hamilton. So good thing he's still around the studio and in the audience today. But before that, let's take a quick ad break.
Thorpey's advice line.
Hi, Thorpey. I've told the kids that Uncle Toby's OTs are full of the goodness of oats.
Don't tell them about the goodness. Just tell them about the great taste. Tell them
they're totally wicked.
Tried that.
Tell them it's
pretty fat, as in PHAT.
Tried that too.
Tell them the
taste of OTs is fully sick.
Are you sure?
Go on.
Thorpey says the taste is fully sick.
Uncle Toby's OTs. Thorpey says the taste is fully sick.
You're up, mate.
What's wrong with this place?
Who the flaming heck put that there?
Dude.
Don't dude me, you long-haired Yahoo.
Eat a Snickers.
Why?
Because you're a cranky old man when you're hungry. Better?
Better.
Get off my lawn!
You're not you when you're hungry. Snickers really satisfies.
I forgot the handbrake.
Welcome to the studio, Tyler. It was so great to chat with you during the week, but I do have a few follow-up questions for you about AI.
Yeah, absolutely.
Perfect. So again, thank you so much for coming in. things happen, but we're glad you made it here. And we also discussed earlier in the week, like the concerns about AI taking our jobs and like job opportunities away from people. Do you think this is like a real threat and like should we be worried or advice do you have?
I think with any sort of industry shakeup like this, there's always a risk of just jobs changing and industries completely changing. However, I think we still have a really good opportunity to start using this as a creative tool.
Yeah.
I think there's a lot of great things that you can do about it. Unfortunately, we are already seeing some changes in the job industry. But like everybody has alluded to as well, it's a very, very good opportunity to start empowering yourself as a creative. I think the Photoshop example is a really good one where, you might not be spending as much time sort of on the tools and doing, essentially grunt work. And I still remain hopeful that it allows creatives to essentially just to be creative.
Yeah. And also like it just kind of helps to speed up the process of something that would normally take such a long period of time that it just condenses that so we can like move on to focus on maybe the ideas and the concepts instead.
Yeah, absolutely. And like everyone has said tonight, it's a great brainstorming tool and just a great way to help you get around your writer's block. Yeah,
for sure. And do you see any like roadblocks jumping off that for like using AI in people's like day-to-day life?
Yeah, I mean, in day-to-day life, you can already see it sort of empowering people to get their jobs done a lot quicker, but you can also see it in the sort of crazy side with like social media algorithms, for example. You know, that all still uses a form of AI. So yeah, even though it seems like a insanely new thing, AI has been around for a while and it, yeah, already is impacting people's lives.
Yeah, and I suppose people just haven't seen it before. Mm. Like now it's just the media's jumped on that and all the industries are like AI and it's the name for it.
Yeah, exactly. That's a really good point. Like ChatGPT has done a really positive thing and also like a slightly negative and scary thing by sort of making this so mainstream and tangible for everybody. So yeah, versions of GPT have been around for years, but yeah, have completely gone unnoticed by the media. But yeah, all of a sudden, now that it is such a accessible tool, that we can just log on and start creating things. Yeah, you're absolutely right. It's just all over the media now. Everyone knows about it.
Yeah, they've just like branded themselves, and now that's what everyone like associates with it.
Yeah,
so
exactly.
It's like, it's really good for them, but it's also like so terrifying. Like it is a mix of like emotions when you're announcing something so massive.
Anything new can always be very terrifying. Yes. And yeah, we're definitely seeing that being the case.
And still it's, you know, it's artificial intelligence, not actual intelligence.
Exactly. Mm. And I wouldn't even go as far as saying artificial intelligence. Like that's still a marketing term. Some people prefer machine learning, but even that's still a little bit disingenuous. Yeah, I always go back to the phone's autocorrect. It's only as smart as what you put in. It's not creating anything. It's just guessing based on
inputs. I suppose it just uses like patterns and like kind of knowledge to put stuff together.
Yeah, exactly.
So yeah, it can't create anything new.
Exactly. Yeah, there's a big argument. Is it actually creating anything new, or is it actually just rehashing existing things? And you know what is new in that point?
Yeah.
What if you watched a whole film and you had no idea and it was like quite a good film and then you kind of realize it's AI? Like, well, would that change your opinion of it? Like, how does that make you think?
Yeah, that's a really good question. I think the Coca-Cola ad's actually a good example. I personally think if I saw it to the end and realized it was AI, I, even as much as I love AI, I would still feel a little bit cheated. I can't really explain why I would feel that. However, if I went into it knowing that it was AI and it was cool, I think that would be a completely different story. Yeah. I think a good example is almost digital art, for example. If you saw a really great Photoshop drawing and you knew it was digital art, that looks great. It's done a great job. However, if somebody's tried to pass it off as like a traditional painting, I think you'd sort of feel a little bit cheated in terms of the lack of artistry in that point.
Yeah. Mm. It's definitely kind of like someone's trying to deceive you for it, like to trick you. And I think that's what people don't like.
Yeah.
But I suppose if you're upfront and honest about it, being like, I'm using this tool to enhance my own work, it makes it people a lot more like susceptible to be open to the concept.
Yeah, absolutely. I think there is some great AI content and AI art out there, but you're absolutely right. When it does get palmed off as, you know, completely real or not generated, it does feel a little bit disingenuous. And yeah, I don't think people need to be disingenuous about it. I think there's a lot of value in creating something that is AI and saying that it's AI.
Yeah, I totally agree. Again, thank you so much for coming today and for like our live interview and everything. It's been great to get your insights and chat with you about how you use AI and what you think of it for the future and everything like that.
No worries, thanks for having me.
I'll definitely be looking into this, but let's go over to Luca, who's going to walk us through this week's quick brief.
Let's go.
Thanks for that, Jaya. Submission you guys sent last week were awesome, but can you guys do better this week? Let's find out. We're keeping it on theme this week, as this week's client is Google with their recently unveiled AI-powered advertising solutions. This is an advanced AI that can generate copy, still images, identify a target audience, and just about anything else a client can use to advertise their business. Your aim is to push this AI towards small e-commerce businesses that rely on the search engine through for a 15 to 30 second draft for an ad that will appear as an audio ad for radio and podcast and a video ad for YouTube pre-roll and other streaming services. This week focuses on how AI tools can help small businesses adopt an informative and helpful tone that draws away from the ethical discourse that AI can create. You can also use this opportunity to attach a personality to AI, which can help warm people up to the idea of its usage. But that's all from me. Back to you guys.
This week's best submission will win a lolly bag with a limited edition Hungry Talk sticker. We're still looking for the best idea for them to be awarded at Scamp Champ. So guys, please get out there and get your quick briefs going. And we'll, here's one from last week.
Shout out to Joe. Beautiful scamp for last week. We'll organise the prize with you, very special. And good luck for everyone doing their briefs this week. I'm very excited to see the submissions.
Yes, thank you all so much for coming to the live studio. The audiences, Tom, Claudio, Aimee, I didn't sign out with you, but you guys are great. Love you all. Guys, please join us next week. You know, bring a date here or something. Have a laugh. But if you really cannot be part of the audience, please, at the very least, can you like, comment, and subscribe? That old trio. Follow us at Instagram at hungry_talks, sorry. And you don't even have to get up to do that. Anyway, as I said, join us next week as we dissect the battle of the blockbusters, Barbie versus Oppenheimer. We learned today that technology isn't always the best, but you know what? There's a bright future ahead. Exactly. We work ahead.
Yep.
Good night.
Good night.
Good night.
Thank you. Thank you.